Hi, I'm Harriet Schock, and this is Andrea Ross-Greene, and we're live on Game Changers with Vicki Abelson. I'm starting by singing a song I wrote and put on my first album in the 70s, and it got just enough airplay for Helen Reddy to hear it on the radio, and then she covered it, and she had the hit with it. But I'm going to play it for you now. I wrote it on an airplane as I was leaving someone for the last time. It was one of the last times I left him for the last time. Yes, it was yourself you were involved with. I would have sworn it was me. I'd found out sooner if you'd only let me close enough to see. That ain't no way to change.
Harriet Schock, and we're gonna talk to okay, so I was the lighting person during that set, and so Pete's following me in because we're gonna sit down inside, and there's no hips in this picture, right, Pete?
No.
There's no hips because my hips lie. Hi everybody, I'm Vicki Abelson, and this is Game Changers, and my guest tonight is Harriet Schock, and I'm so happy that you're here. Harriet has been a stalwart woman who writes for 10 years, I think, that you've been coming, and Andrea as well. And who's counting? Yeah, hi, Jay.
But 10?
Because Women Who Write's going into we're in our 11th year, and I don't think you guys came at the very beginning. How did you find
it? I think Tracy Newman told me about it.
Okay, and I have no idea how Tracy found all right, I'm finding us, because I want to say hi to everybody who's watching, that I was watching the names go by as you guys were singing.
Yeah.
And Eileen Angel was saying, I'm loving this. Hi, Eileen. Maybe it was Sharon who said that. Hi, Sharon Rothberg. It's good to see you. Hi, John Green. Hi, Phil Isaacson. Who else was I looking at? Linda Apsey's watching. Hi, Linda. We love you. Mary Cross and Karen Page.
Mary Cross?
Cross. Is it Cross? C-R-O-S-E. Yeah. Nancy Kellel?
Nancy Kellel
is in the house.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we have all our friends. Tracy's watching. Hi, Tracy.
Hi, Tracy.
Michelle Vreeland is watching. Michelle, I haven't seen you in ages.
My neighbor.
Is she? Yeah. Oh yeah. Okay. Good. So, all right. So I'm trying to get us on here too, so we'll be able to keep track of
who. Why am I waving? Oh, okay.
No, because there's a delay. But you were getting all kinds. Look at this. We're getting all kinds of love. One person accidentally hit the angry face. You're not angry at us, are you? If you're not, why would you be angry at us?
Already. We haven't even done anything.
I mean, we haven't done anything. There's no reason to be angry.
Later.
There's no reason to be angry at us. I don't know why it's doing this weird thing where it won't let me see, but I can see on here.
I can see.
So, well, it's not letting me see who the... who's watching? Why is it doing?
What about over there?
So there we can. So I'm not even gonna do this one. This thing's always giving me a hard
time. I think this happened with Coco. You put something away.
It's just driving me crazy. Before we get into Harriet's story, I want to give a shout out to Rick Smokey. Who?
Oh, wonderful.
Okay, now you guys were beneficiaries of Rick. Do you remember when we used to have swag every single month?
Swag.
Right? He would give us calendars. He'd give us pads. He'd give us tissue box.
And I'm still using all the pads.
Okay, right. And yeah. So here's Harriet on the tissue box with.
I'm on the Kleenex box.
You're on the tissue. And you know what? You were with us the day the reason we got a tissue box is because the day that you sang, Mackenzie Phillips read that very sad passage from her.
That's when I met Suzanne Wong, and she was there.
And a shout out to Suzanne Wong. By the way, on Sunday, there's going to be an international. Yes. What is it called?
A visualization
for her good health, her perfect health, and it's
right.
At 2 p.m. Pacific time, I believe, but everywhere around the world.
It's on all of our Facebook pages.
It's on
exactly
all of our pages.
When to do it.
Right, and we're all going to visualize Suzanne's perfect health and love her back for
right.
health.
That's
and
right.
So on this particular day, and here's Tracy, here you are on the tissue box, Tracy. You did it with Jackie Collins, yeah. And there's, yeah. So
I was there.
Yeah, I'm sure you guys were. So anyway, this day that Mackenzie Phillips read to us, we were all crying, and somebody said, have that swag guy of yours, that Rick Smokey from Quick Impressions in Chicago, make us a tissue box.
Oh, I see. That.
And he did. And that's amazing. And he's also made my bookmarks, and he's made my business cards. And the thing is, he'll do anything for you. And if you ever need anything for any of your gigs, do you do printed stuff?
Oh, yeah.
He has never charged an artist. He is he's an angel from the heavens.
He will
be happy to do something for it. Happy
That's
to.
Wonderful.
He's really an angel, and
he
is a wonderful man. He's
because
doing
the
these
veterans.
Fabulous
yes.
PSAs for the veterans. And Rick, when you hear what Harriet and Andrea did for you for the veterans, just prepared for you tonight. I'm really excited about it. So. Anyway, so that's Rick Smokey. If you need anything printed out there, and you tell him that you're a friend of mine, of Game Changers, of Pete George's. Hi, Pete. Pete's busy checking the sound. Are we good sound, Pete?
Sounds really loud in me.
Okay, everybody out there, tell us if our sound is good.
Linda's
okay?
having a hard time, but
who is
Linda?
if Linda's having a hard time with the sound.
But Hope said she can hear just fine.
Linda, I don't know. Hope, let's make sure.
Some people can't hear.
Okay, if people can't hear, that's not good. We want to check that microphone and make sure that, let's make sure that the microphone's good. Let's turn this sucker just all the way up, even though we don't know that that doesn't do anything. But let's make sure you guys can hear. We're adjusting, so let us know if it's any better for you.
Is that better?
Yeah, let us know if that's better, because the microphone's now, let's keep that. Ooh, that's very phallic right there. And so also, besides Rick Smokey of Quick Impressions in Chicago, I have to give a shout out to my hairdresser, who I'm going to go see. Hair Crush Love, her fuck off hairspray. But Nicole, I need a haircut. This is why I've gone curly. But you know, I haven't used a flat iron in the last few days, and I've gotten more compliments wearing it just natural. So I don't know. It saves a lot of time and effort when
it's
I
beautiful.
Just
yeah. You didn't like, even use a flat iron?
No, this is curly. This is but normally I do. Normally I. You know, every hair has to be, and no, this I can just do whatever I want. It's nice. But it looks a little messy, but, you know, all right. So I got the feathers going on. So anyway, so Nicole Venables of the Ruby Begonia Salon in Studio City is just an extraordinary hairdresser, and only my hairdresser and you know for sure. And yes, for sure, this is not the color that I was born with, but nor would it be the color that I am now. Okay, so Harriet.
Uh-huh.
David Lucky. Hi, David.
David,
I love you.
David Lucky. I'm still waiting for my quote.
All right.
He knows what I mean.
Cynthia is watching. Two Cynthias. Nick Beck is watching all the way from London. Nick stays up in the middle of the night to watch us live.
Which
Hi, Nick.
Two Cynthias?
Okay, Cynthia, not Cynthia Carl.
Okay,
Cynthia Land.
Land, yeah.
And there's another Cynthia I saw. There's a Hope Hunter. Hi, Hope.
Hi, Hope.
Who's the other Cynthia? There was another Cynthia here, and now I've lost her. All right. Tova. Hi, Tova.
Tova.
Yeah, Tova. Yeah. I love Tova. Tova, you've got to come back.
I met her at Women Who Write.
Yeah, Tova's going to be back this month. Let's see who else. All right, I've said most. Bart. Hi, Bart. Hi, who else are we seeing?
I told everyone to comment, so now.
Yeah, no, this is good. This is, Linda, can you hear now? I see that you're on there. Tell us if the sound is any better for you. I know you were struggling. Everybody, tell Pete if the sound is a problem. Pete, come on in here and talk to us about what you're doing. Pete's checking the sound, and he's all plugged in. But come on over and say hello while
sure
you're...
Sure.
Hey, Pete.
Hey.
Hi, Pete.
Hey,
this is Pete George. He's the rock and roll comedian.
That's what they say.
So, Pete, what's coming up for you? We got anything we want to talk
Nothing
about?
Nothing within the next week or two.
Okay, so...
Shows at the winery over the weekend were phenomenal.
Excellent.
In Temecula.
Nice.
And that's about it. You know,
but you can always find Pete online.
TheRockstarOfComedy.com, Facebook, Instagram, MySpace.
MySpace is making a comeback.
That's right. I'm still selling 8-tracks on there. So that's really good.
Oh, that's really good. Well, Pete, thank you for doing this.
Thank you.
Okay, so Pete's going
to
be taking your questions, and he's going to be letting us know.
Yes.
So talk to Pete. Talk to us and tell us if you've got any questions for Harry.
Yeah, absolutely. Any questions you have, I will be reading them, and I'm single. Okay, anyway.
And he's so cute.
And he looks like Rob Lowe and Robert Downey Jr. both.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's a mouthful right there.
I should go back on camera.
You should go back on camera. Tracy Newman just said hi to you, Pete.
Hey,
and
Tracy.
Cynthia Land said hi to you, Harriet. Aww. Nobody's saying hi to me. So I don't know what the hell is going on here. Nobody's saying hi to me.
Your hairdresser.
Oh, there's Sarah Nimitz is on here. Hi, Sarah.
Sarah,
I'm coming to see you on Friday night at the Hotel Cafe. Sarah and Snuffy Walden are going to be at the Hotel Cafe Friday night at 9 p.m. doing an hour show with a full band.
They are so good.
They're so excellent. We have to get them back to the living room because Sarah's got a new CD, a new album. An album. I still say album because that's where
because that's what it is.
Andrea, roll yourself in here for a second and say hi. I think you're going to need to come around. Otherwise, we won't see. This is Andrea Ross-Greene, and for those of you who heard that beautiful song at the beginning, Andrea and Harriet have been performing together for how many years?
since about 2005
no.
or so.
Well, they'll contradict.
We met in 2002.
How'd you guys meet?
Well, it's a long story.
All right, you don't have to tell the story now, but they are very, very good friends. They write music together. They sing music together.
No, we don't. We wrote that one song.
Oh, the one right. song for the servicemen. But you guys are in perfect harmony. And I got to co-star with both of you in Henry Jaglom's The
Anchor. And how did you meet Henry?
I met him. I'm going to tell that story.
Okay.
Hey, I always credit you. I always credit you. Believe me, if it were not for you guys, I would not have had a 60 seconds alone with Michael Imperioli on screen, which is the...
I took that picture.
And you took that fabulous photo. Andrea took a fabulous photo. Anyway, so, Andrea, we're going to have you come back and sing at the end of the show. I don't want to keep you on your knees.
All right.
That's what he said. I'm sorry, but I couldn't help it. I go there. You know, and Harriet, Rick Smokey, hi, Rick is watching. Rick, you missed our whole tribute to you at the beginning of the show. You have to go back and watch.
It was
nice, right?
Yeah, it was wonderful. We loved what you do.
We have really Jeffrey do. Wilson's watching. We have a Mitch Weissman. Hi, Mitch. The original fake Paul is watching from Beatlemania. Were you there when Mitch opened for Gary Marshall in the living room?
I don't think I was.
Wow.
I can't believe it.
That, you know, we had Gary. He was at the peak of his brilliance and handsomeness. He was so handsome the day he was in the living room. And Pete and Mitch did Beatles songs, and Mitch was the original Paul McCartney on Broadway and in the movie of Beatlemania, and he did She Loves You, and he's fabulous. He shakes his head just like Paul. I love you, Mitch. I miss you. So anyway, and Mickey, hi Mickey. Rick is sorry he missed it. Rick, you know, the nice thing about doing live on the Facebook is that there's a replay afterwards and you get to watch it as many times as you want. We love you. I also told Harry you're going to make shit for her for free. So expect a call. Linda's saying, was fun when Mitch was, it was great. And Mitch, we want you back. Mitch was supposed to come back and sing with Esai Morales.
Oh.
Wasn't that fun when Esai did those Beatles songs?
Yeah.
Oh my God, he was so fun. Andrea, we miss you at Women Who Riot. You have to come. I know you're working.
But that monologue was the best thing ever.
Felix Solis.
Unbelievable.
Felix Solis, you are a monster. That was, right?
Oh.
I don't know that I've never seen better acting. I've seen other brilliant performances in my life on Broadway, but I've never seen better.
I'm so glad you had him do that monologue
right?
that you saw, and not some other thing that you hadn't
seen.
You
exactly,
know,
because
I,
that when
always we, doing that.
I know. Or they say, I love this song you do, but sing the other one. That's why we had to have you open with Ain't No Way to Treat a Lady, because you've written...
It's
like thousands, right?
A
ridiculous amount of songs. Crazy number of songs. But this is the song, platinum record, gold record, Grammy nomination. I mean, that's huge. That's a huge accomplishment.
Well, it gave my parents something to talk about before they died. It was important to me that, you know.
Yeah. My father passed before Carl Reiner came to the living room, but that would have been... I know he was with... us that day because I heard an owl hooting outside my window, and I'm convinced my father was there that day. Okay, so let's talk about you, Harry, because you know I'm really excited about doing this show with you because I don't know much about how you came to do what you do. I know that. Okay, so I know you have an accent. So where'd you grow up?
Dallas.
Okay,
I'm from Dallas.
Well, so were you a big city girl?
Yes.
My chair's making. I'm making so much noise. I'm not doing that. It's just the chair.
People think, they say, you're from Texas, you know, cowboy boots and hats. No.
Cosmopolitan.
The home of Neiman Marcus.
Yes.
Can we talk? So that's where I'm from.
Were you affluent?
Well,
yes. Andrea's saying yes.
No. I mean, I asked my father one time if we were millionaires, and he said no. And I said, well, are we thousandaires? And he said, yes, we're thousandaires. He was a dermatologist.
Oh, well, okay. So there was, you weren't exactly impoverished then.
No.
Yeah. Okay, so that's good. So Faith Prince, do you know Faith Prince? Faith Prince, I love you, and I'm going to get you on here and in the living room if it kills. Faith Prince was Adelaide in A Person Can Develop a Cult, and she won a Tony for. She is a brilliant actress, musical theater star. Oh. She's phenomenal. I love you, Faith. And I shall not rest. Hi, Cheryl Nimitz. I see you. I will see you on Friday night at the gig. Okay, so let's talk about you growing up in Texas. Are you sick? In thank you.
It makes a difference.
It does make a difference. Yeah. You're growing up in Dallas. Are you singing out of the womb? Are your parents musical?
My father was very musical.
The dermatologist.
Yes, he put himself through college and part of medical school playing in a jazz band. He played marimba and cello.
Wait, what is marimba?
A marimba is like a xylophone with wooden wooden, what do you call it? Wooden, it's not metal.
Okay.
And I had it right over there until a few months ago, my whole life.
Wow.
Yeah, but I could only play whispering with three mallets, and I wanted it to actually be played, so I put it somewhere else in a wonderful studio, which I won't mention.
You know, but I love that you did that. I had this fantastic Rickenbacker bass that was sitting in a beautiful case for too many years, and I had to finally give it to somebody who was going to play it.
Yeah,
well,
his cello is at the same studio, and now they're it's so
wonderful. Nice.
Yeah.
So did your father do that all through his life, or did he stop?
No, his father, who started the University of Texas band and the chemical engineering department.
Wait,
grandfather.
So, yeah. So your grandfather and your father are both science and art.
Yeah.
Wow,
and
both sides of the brain.
My grandfather, they call it the Schock Laboratories after him, the chemical engineering department. But he said to my father, well, what's it going to be, music or medicine? So he became a doctor, you know, and a dermatologist in particular.
Do you think he had any regret?
I think he really loved that I got to do it.
Aww.
You know, and we played music together. He played the marimba, I played the piano.
Okay, so when did you start? When did you start being musical?
4 years old. He would play things on the piano, mm-hmm. and he would show me chords, and then I would play, and eventually I'd say, I know. And I started playing by ear. And then when I took piano lessons, I say to my teacher, just play it enough so I'll know if I even want to learn to read the music. So she'd play it, and then I would play it by ear and pretend to read the music. Because I never got that whole thing about the notes and the rhythm of the notes. Really, I can't.
I think this is fascinating. I had to take clarinet. I had to take an instrument in junior high and band, in orchestra band, uh-huh. whatever, and I never learned to read the music. So I would put my hair over and I would fake that I was reading the music, and I was just, yeah.
You were
so I totally, and I did the same thing with typing, which to this day I still plod along, but so I relate to this.
Well, my father blacked out all the keys on the typewriter and gave me a chart.
Wow.
So I can type like a demon.
Wow, that's an interesting way to do it.
Yeah, because I never hunt and peck because I just know where they are.
Wow. Okay, I'm loving that.
What's weird is playing the piano and then going and typing, is some weird thing happens in your brain because you've been playing chords and then you're...
So you kind of type the way you type rhythmically?
They're totally different. And the mind has to do a severe about face.
Interesting. Really?
How does the mind do an about face?
I don't know, but I like that lyric. I like that lyric. The mind does an about face. I'm liking that a lot. You have some extraordinary lyrics. And Tracy Newman, hi Tracy. Tracy did a beautiful write-up of the show that we saw recently.
Yeah, I really appreciated it.
It was wonderful, and I love the lyrics of yours that she pulled out. I actually read them to a composer today. But I'm not going to talk about that. We'll talk about that another time. But,
okay.
But I was really impressed with your... I'm so impressed with you. I mean, because when I listen to your music, I just listen to your music. I'm not pulling it apart.
Right.
You know, like, it moves me. Mm-hmm. But I don't like, hang on to a word and say, oh, wow, that was really...
But, I hope not.
Yeah.
Because that takes people out of the experience.
Exactly. But I'm in the music with you, but then sitting and reading it on the page, I was like, wow, that's profound.
Oh,
wow,
okay.
That's amazing. So, okay, so you're in Texas, you're 4 years old, are you singing too? When do you start to sing?
No, well, the funny thing is, my sister actually didn't play the piano, so when we would perform together, mm-hmm. I would play and she would sing. So I thought that meant I couldn't sing, so I never sang until I was grown and out here. And
wait, stop. You didn't sing your whole life? You weren't in
a
choir?
I was in a choir, I sang and stuff like that. And I would sing harmony on the bus.
How did you learn to sing harmony?
I could hear the chords.
I don't know how to sing harmony, yeah. So, okay.
Yeah, loved it. And so...
So you weren't taught? You just...
No. You can't teach someone... You can't give someone an ear. You can help them develop it. But, you know...
I just want to say right now, we're going to get into this a lot more later. Harriet is the premier songwriting teacher in Los Angeles. She has taught everybody who's written hit songs themselves. And at this very table, she teaches the class. We'll talk about that.
Yeah, this is where I sit. But, so
you can teach somebody to write a song.
Well, that's a whole different thing. There's steps. I have a step-by-step method.
Okay, we'll get to that.
Yeah, we'll get to that. But yeah, I sang harmony on the bus. So, but I never sang lead or anything, but I had, when I was out here, I came out here.
Why did you come out?
I came out here married to an actor.
Oh.
Oh, you good boss. Yeah.
Oh, you good boss.
I was married to him. He was very nice, and we're still in touch.
Oh.
I don't think he's watching, but he was a good person. It was just not right, you know. He was an actor. I was a songwriter.
So, were you a songwriter when you came?
When did you start? I was trying to be a songwriter.
What did you go to school for?
English major.
Okay. Well, that's totally related.
Yeah, I was an English major.
And what did you want to be when you grew up? What was the plan?
Well, at my 7 years old, I'd go to the grocery store with my mother, and while she was shopping, I would be looking at the stationery. I thought, I want to write things on paper. That's all I knew. So she would dictate out of books, and I would write the words down. That, to me, was really fun. Then, in the 7th grade, I started writing poetry. You know, it was so much easier than writing a whole long paper, and they let me do it, so I would always write a poem. And then even in college, I took a poetry writing course where you go to the teacher's office, the professor, mm-hmm. and you just go over it and everything. And I thought, oh, I love writing poetry, and I love playing the piano, but it didn't occur to me until I was in college. And okay, don't laugh. Don't roll your eyes. I was in a sorority. Okay? I knew it.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Well, you know how you know me.
I was in a girls' prep school in high school, and there were only 68 of us.
And that prepared you for that, then?
No, it was like I needed something smaller than the University of Texas, where there were, you know, 300 people in one class.
Right. Right.
So I joined that, and we had this kind of contest between all of them called, I don't remember, Stunt Night, or it wasn't that, but it was, and so I wrote the shows, and every time I wrote the show, we won, and I thought, God, wouldn't that be great, but no one does that for a living, so I got a teaching certificate, not taking 1 hour of education classes.
Hey, wait a minute. No. I had to take a lot of it. How'd you get that?
It was advanced standing. You just took the test.
Wow.
So I got a double major, but never took one class in it. And then I beta cap on the whole thing, you know.
Nice.
And so, yep. And then I thought, oh, how do I use an English degree? So I got a job as an advertising copywriter right out of school.
Mm-hmm.
And then right away I got a publishing deal. So.
Okay, so now how did that happen?
Well, I the only place you could play original material in the 70s, at least to my knowledge, was gay bars in Santa Monica. And so I played this place called the Bitter End West. You know, the Bitter End
in
New York.
I ran the club next door to the Bitter End in New York.
Yeah, the Bitter End West was nothing like the Bitter End.
Okay.
But, you know, it was...
Different owners?
It was next to the Grieger Gaiety Delicatessen. And anyway, I played there every Monday night. And I would go in there and play the piano and sing my songs. And believe me, those guys were not there to see the white chick at the piano. You know, they were so not interested. So I had to enroll.
I think we have to turn these down a little. I think we're a little bright. Sorry, I think we're a little hot. I'm going to have... We're a little hot, can't you tell? I'm going to have P turn it down, and I'm going to come sit this way with you.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I wanted to enroll them in my song, so I started talking to them, and that's what unleashed the monster you saw the other night.
Which is phenomenal.
I do introduce my song. So anyway,
yes.
I've started singing there, mm-hmm. and I went to an ASCAP meeting and ran into Roger Gordon, who was a publisher, and I said, why don't you come see me at the Bitter End West? And then I got a publishing deal. It was like, if I had known, it was really much harder than that. But anyway...
How many songs did you have when you had a when you got a publishing deal, approximately?
Well, probably not more than 15 or 20.
Okay, that's a lot.
I just started writing. Mm-hmm. And then they took me to a record label, and I got signed, actually, to Columbia. And then during the Paola scandal, all of Jack Gold was the man who signed me. All of his acts got dropped.
Ooh.
And then... they took me to Russ Regan at 20th Century Records, and he signed me. So I just got a car out of the first deal. And
all
since I'd gotten a divorce and he had the car, I really needed one. So anyway, I made three albums for Russ Regan at 20th Century Records, and on the first one was the song you heard in there.
Ain't No Way to Treat a Lady.
And so Helen heard it on the radio. She had the hit. And other people recorded other songs, like Manfred Mann recorded the title song.
And so...
Hollywood Town.
Somebody, I was listening to your... I was listening to your version of your songs from way back in the day today, and...
What?
I was listening... I in Hollywood Town. I heard, you know, a bunch of songs from that, and I was listening to stuff that was... You know, stuff that... has been around for a while.
Yeah.
And your voice was, you had this perfect, pure pop voice.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I like a voice with character, and you have character in your voice now, which I love because it's who you are.
Mm-hmm.
But in those days, you had that radio voice. You had that radio voice.
Yeah. Yeah, I know what you mean.
You know?
It was funny. I had disc jockeys saying, you know, I heard your record, and I thought it was a polished Anne Murray record. I didn't know you really had anything to say until my wife made me take it home and listen to it.
You did have sort of you had that Anne Murray polish.
Well, I loved Anne Murray, but she wasn't a writer.
And you had your own sound. But I just mean it was a very polished pop sound.
Yeah, but I think... See, it was the day that Carole King was getting played, and so they didn't realize I actually had something to say because it sounded like a polished record with so too many strings. And,
uh-huh.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
But
it wasn't just you and your piano.
Yeah, and a few instruments.
Mm-hmm. So, okay, so what happens to... Are you're making a living as a songwriter?
Yeah.
And as an artist?
I have a publishing deal.
Are you playing out around...
Yeah, I mean, the first time I ever played, really publicly, Russ Regan, who was head of the label, had everyone who was anybody to a show at the Troubadour and introduced me.
Wow.
And I was so horrified. I mean, so this is what I said. I said, you know, performing is kind of like sex. The first few times you do it, you're too scared to enjoy it. You got an idea there's something there you're going to like later. I couldn't believe it. I knew if I just told them how scared I really was, they'd be on my side.
It was that was a great way to say it.
It was heaven. I loved it. I was like a baby shark that had tasted blood when I heard that applause. I said, oh boy, I'm in for it now.
And so even at the beginning, I love the fact that you're a singer-songwriter who tells the story. That, to me, is what a show should be.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the great John Prine and Steve Goodman and all the people that I love that I used to
Thank
go
you.
See that, yeah. that, you know, would do that. And there aren't a lot of artists that do that anymore. So it's really a lost art. And you're funny and charming, as we know. And it's a beautiful thing. If you have an opportunity to see Harry, where can people see you?
June 2nd, I'm doing a showcase where I'm singing two songs and showcasing other people.
Okay, so we'll look for that. But we'll always on the Women Who Write group page, Harriet shows, I hope, are always there.
Yeah,
we should
always
be there. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and on Harriet's page, you should follow Harriet. How can they follow you? Facebook. And Twitter and Instagram.
Yeah, I'm everywhere.
Except she's Schock Harriet.
Schock Harriet on Instagram, which, yeah.
So you're married to an actor, you're out here, you're signed.
That was back then.
Right.
I'm married to someone else now.
Yes.
We got divorced right away. I wasn't married to him when I got signed to a record deal.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And so all that time I was by myself, mm-hmm. and that worked really well for me.
Okay.
And so much so that I thought I would never marry again. And if I did, he would have to live in the house next door. But it worked out.
Oh. I just got that. Yes.
Yeah, like yeah. Jean-Paul Sartre and Simone de Beauvoir.
I know a few people who do down the street and kind of deal.
But anyway, mm-hmm. so yeah, I was out here and I made three albums for Russ Regan, who just passed away last year. He was beloved mm-hmm. by everyone who knew him. Mm-hmm. And I got, you know, a lot of airplay. Now, in those days, KNX FM was a radio station. It played album cuts. Wow. And they played every cut on all three albums. I mean, I can look at my ASCAP statement. They're all there.
So now, is this like, in New York, it was WNEW and
oh, I got played on that, too.
Okay, yeah. So it's that kind of free where the DJs had their own...
Yeah.
Yes. Their own say. So they were playing all of your music.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's how a lot of people heard them and decided to cover them.
Okay, so let's talk about some of the people that covered your music.
Well, Manfred Mann mm-hmm. covered Hollywood Town. And
was that your first cover song?
No, Ain't No Way to Treat a Lady. Wait a minute. Let me look at this. Maybe there were some others.
So if you started with Ain't No Way to... That's a hell of a place to start.
No, That's the Way It Is With You was cut by the Partridge Family.
Oh, my God. And when Shirley came, right. Shirley Jones came to the living room and Harriet got to talk to her about that. That's so great.
Yeah, and then Hold Me was in a movie and, you know...
So all that stuff was happening for you very early.
Yeah. But the funny thing is, like, I had a publishing deal. They were paying me by the week my money that they were going to recoup.
Right.
Which they did recoup. Mm-hmm. But I hadn't had a hit yet, so they dropped my option. Then I had a hit, and they said, oh, wait a minute. We didn't mean... And by then I was already gone, you know.
Yeah, I love it. I love it. I love that. I'm just looking... Pete, do we have... Before we continue, do we have any questions yet for Harriet?
We have one question so far.
Okay.
Would you like to know what it is?
We would.
All right. You have so darn many songs. How do you choose those you play in your show?
God, that's a really good question. That must be a songwriter.
Who asked that question, Pete?
Nancy.
Colella. It's funny because I do entirely different show from the ones I've done before. Because this time I had seven new songs and I was determined to do all of them.
That's so phenomenal.
And I did. And my little orchestra is just so wonderful.
Oh my God.
So a part of it, Nancy, was I wanted to do the songs that they could play on easily. I mean, that they would sound right on. I have flute. Cello,
bass,
and violin. Mm-hmm. And so the little orchestra, you know, doesn't all play all the time, mm-hmm. but when they do play,
it was amazing.
I get to sit in the middle of it. I have the best seat of all. So part of it is what would go together with all that, you know. And, you know, people say, oh, you can't do all ballads. Oh, yes, you can, if that's all you write. Actually, I have more rhythmic things, too, and I can divide it up. But mostly I think of how the melodies will go together. And if anything is, like, too much like something else, I try not to do them next to each other. You know, it's really hard. But also there's an arc lyrically. You know, you want to take people somewhere and bring them back safely.
I love that because a lot of songwriters don't think about that either. A lot of artists, they do songs and things that don't relate and the mood keeps changing. And yours was a progression and it was a trip.
I think what's different about, like when you said I tell stories and stuff, a lot of people will tell you exactly, like if the song says, my acting teacher, Gary Imhoff, he tells us, he says, like if the song says, I met a man, his name was John, we kissed under the moonlight. Then you tell them that, and then you sing the song. I met a man, his name was John, we kissed him. So what I learned to do in the gay clubs, because I had to get their attention, I will create a riddle which the song will solve. But the riddle is in their life. So they have to hear the song to figure out how to solve it.
Okay, so give us an example of what that might be.
Well, like, have you ever been with someone and you just hit your head against a brick wall forever,
yes,
you know, and you love them, but something happened in their life that they just don't get it, you know, and so somehow if they're asleep for 8 years, that slamming door can wake them right up, you know. And so then you either, there are a few of my songs I could do after that, but.
Yeah.
But, you know, I have a song that starts, I can't go back and slap the hands of your mama. And I can't poison all those girls who did you wrong. So it's about how.
Perfect.
I loved you, you just didn't get it.
Okay. Yeah, I get it and I like it. And that, it also piques people's interest to pay attention.
Yeah.
And to really listen. Which
yeah, I've had men especially say, I had to listen because I knew that I was doing this to my girlfriend and I wanted to know how to solve the problem.
Wow.
It was great.
Do you give the solution in there?
I did. I told them, yeah, not to ever do that again.
That's a good solution. I like that for a solution.
But yeah.
I bet that solution.
Don't do that. It hurts when I do this. Yeah,
that solution works for me. So your music is landing. Roberta Flack, how did that happen?
Oh, I wrote with a wonderful keyboard person who's passed away, but his name was Smitty Smith, William D. Smitty Smith, and he wrote a melody, which I wrote the words to. It was called Happiness, and she heard it, and she recorded it on an album, and that was a dream come true.
And how about Smokey Robinson?
Well, you know, before that was Johnny Mathis.
Oh,
yeah. He recorded a song of mine called Ooh, What We Do. And I've never recorded the song, but I was in the studio with him because he didn't know how it went yet. So I had to sing it with the track they were cutting.
Oh, my God.
And he had a friend there, and he said, listen to these lyrics. He said, I drink up your liquid movements like I'm dying of thirst. And I thought, I've gone to heaven now. Because when I was a child, I walked around the house with his albums like this.
Okay, we didn't even do that. Let's stop with who recorded your songs and go back to that. What was the music you were listening to when you were growing up?
Oh, my heavens. Well, my father listened to classical music. Mm-hmm. And then I would listen to, I loved Ella Fitzgerald. So I would listen to all the records she made of great composers like Gershwin, Rodgers and Hart, Cole Porter. So even though that wasn't what was on the radio then, I grew up listening to these great songwriters, and I'm so glad because, you know, that to me is, that's really good writing. Rodgers and Hart, you know, Cole Porter, it doesn't get any better.
Yeah.
So, and then, you know, then
And that informed what you do.
Yeah, and I mean, I grew up with the Beatles like everybody else, and Carole King and Joni Mitchell, and that was very important. But when I was really little, I heard these other people.
So when you were a fledging singer-songwriter, who was your model? Like, I would like a career like that.
I never thought of that.
Okay.
Careers and that. No. I Carole King actually came to a show of mine.
Oh.
She called my publisher and she said, this girl's going to be a superstar. And he dropped my option the next week. But it was not related. I mean, he didn't hear a hit. He didn't know that he had one in the company. But she was so kind to me and she really loved what I did. So she was an idol. And Joni Mitchell and James Taylor and Don Henley.
So what do you have? We're going to get to your songwriting thing, but does one come before the other? Does lyric come before music? Does one come before the other, or is it different?
It depends. You know, it's funny. I can be at another piano that isn't mine, mm-hmm. and I'll write like a whole different melody. And one time, mm-hmm. like I just wrote the melody, and then I put the words. Usually, I will have something I want to say, mm-hmm. and I'll start it that way with a little bit of a melody and a lyric. But frequently, I will write some lines of lyric first. But when I write with Misha Segal, whom you sat with
Misha.
My show.
Hi, yes, Misha. She's lovely.
Oh, yeah. We've written like 300 songs together. We're going to do a whole show of our stuff, too. But he sends me he used to send me the melodies first, or he would write them while I was sitting there, and then I would write the words to it. But we've written a couple of shows since we switched over, and I had to write the lyric first because it was for the musical. And you can't just start with a melody when you're writing a musical.
Right.
I had to have
to have the story, and it's your course.
So we can write either way. And when Arthur Hamilton gives me a lyric like I was blessed to receive from him a couple of times, you know, he wrote Cry Me a River. Mm-hmm. He gives me the lyric, mm-hmm. and it just leaps off the page for melody.
Wow.
And when Andrea gave me the song for the veterans that you heard, I wrote the melody second.
Uh-huh.
So whatever they've got, I write the other thing.
Right.
If they give me the melody, I write the...
And you collaborate with a lot of people.
I actually mostly don't collaborate. Everything I've ever... Pretty much you heard Hillary Rollins...
Mm-hmm. Misha Segal.
Yeah, Misha Segal and Arthur Hamilton.
I have a lot of people. Oh, okay.
But I have written with Kenny Hirsch and other people. Mm-hmm. You know, I just generally write by myself.
Okay. So the artists that have covered you, so how did the Smokey Robinson thing happen?
Well, Smokey sang first time on a Ferris wheel, which you heard the other
night.
Which
is amazing.
But he sang it in the movie it was written for. Now, I don't know if you know the story of how that song got written. We were signed to Motown's publishing company, Jobette.
Okay.
And Suzanne Costin told us at the time, we need a song that does this, and it's a love song. So we wrote it. Mm-hmm. He wrote this gorgeous melody, and mm-hmm. so I wrote the lyric. We took it to Mr. Gordy, Barry Gordy, mm-hmm. and he said, what did you write a love song for? There's no love scene in this movie. What are you thinking? So he put it on. It's 2 a.m. He calls the head of TriStar and says, we are reshooting the end of the movie for this song.
Oh,
they rewrote the film and shot it. Yeah, no. I mean, this is like...
Wow.
That's not the only story with this
Wait,
song.
Wait, what film is it? What's the name of the
Barry
film?
Barry Gordy's The Last Dragon. Sort of a cult following.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was at the end of the movie, and Carl Anderson, who played Judas in Jesus Christ Superstar, mm-hmm. sang the demo, and it was so magnificent. Mm-hmm. So Mr. Gordy showed it to Stevie Wonder, and he said, no, I mean, because Carl's range, you know, it's unbelievable. So Smokey is wonderful, but he is not a James Ingram kind of Carl Anderson type of mm-hmm. singer. He's
right.
a different kind of singer.
Right.
But he did a lovely job, and it was at the end of the film, which they reshot.
That is crazy.
Yeah.
So what other stuff like that? So I know that Pippi Longstocking.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, the man who directed Pippi Longstocking mm-hmm. ran into someone who knows me at the celebration of finding the girl. They looked through thousands of girls,
oh, wow.
and they found Tammy Aaron.
Mm-hmm.
And then by the time they shot the film, they had to, you know, bind her breasts because it took so long to raise the money. But we had already written the songs,
mm-hmm.
and her mouth was moving to them. So even though everyone else in town was trying to get this project, we helped them raise the money by writing the songs first.
Wow.
So
you did it on spec?
Well, we got paid, but after
yeah.
they raised the money. So Ken Anakin, who directed it, met my friend, and he said, I know someone who wrote Ain't No Way to Treat a Lady. He said, I want her for my film because Pippi lives alone with a horse and a monkey and she's a feminist. I thought, whatever gets you the job, you know what I mean? So I brought Misha into it, who ended up scoring the movie as well. and buying half of my duplex. But anyway, it was very wonderful nice. Because he did a beautiful job with the score mm-hmm. as well. But what would happen with him is, like, he would write this great melody, and I'd go downstairs. We lived on two sides of a duplex. This is where I got the idea. And downstairs for tea, I'd come back up. He'd completely written a different melody. I said, wait a minute. What happened to Pippi Longstocking? What happened to that? Because I would give him the title, and then he'd write. And he'd say, oh, no, then I just decided, no, we're going back to that one, you know. So you have to watch composers who are like, especially if they're jazzers at heart, they always want to change everything. But no.
Are you a composer? Do you score as well?
Well, yeah. You know, I did a couple of Henry Jaglom.
Yes, I know that. We're going to get to Henry's films.
But anyway, no, Misha's just, he just exudes melodies. Just, he could write a melody under any circumstances, underwater. I mean, the man is a genius, really.
Wow. I would love to have you two together do Women Who Write. Can you do that? He doesn't like to play electric piano, though. He doesn't.
No,
like
he
to.
Doesn't.
Yeah.
And maybe when we are going to do our show, we could.
Right.
But you still owe me one because I got.
No,
I
know.
My foot.
Well, we're going to do it in the next couple months.
Okay.
I know. Harriet was supposed to do. You've done it twice, but you were supposed to do the third one, and yeah, you broke your foot. That was not fun. Yeah. So
I didn't see Hamilton because of it.
Really?
I had tickets to Hamilton.
Oh, no. That's not a good thing to miss. I see there's a question, Pete, from Sharon. Do you want to read us the question?
Yeah, I've got quite a few questions.
Okay, let's go. Let's have some questions.
Let me see. Okay.
Right.
Did you ever dream a tune and wonder if it was original or something you heard, and yet it was your own, like Paul McCartney dreamed up yesterday?
I have dreamed tunes. But I can't remember them when I wake up. And, of course, they're the best song I ever wrote, but then I never remember them. So, no, I haven't had the Paul McCartney experience.
Okay. And what inspires you to keep writing year after year?
Life. Mm. I mean, I just love the process of songwriting, you know. And so I write songs because I have something to say to somebody. It's usually that.
Have you always gotten to have it land with the person that inspired it?
Oh, no. I've written songs. I have a particular song I wrote for someone. He's probably come to every show I've done for the last 30 years, and he still doesn't know it was me.
No,
oh,
stop.
Oh, seriously.
Oh, come on. Men are so thick. Men, you're thick. I mean, come on. Get with the program. That's crazy. And you've never said this was...
I may have said it, but I'm not sure he heard it.
Wow. Oh, well, that kind of says it all right there.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
One more.
Go ahead.
What is your favorite song that you've written?
Mm. Oh, dear.
Wow. That's like, who's your favorite child? Harry.
Yeah.
No, I'm kidding.
Sophie's choice.
I love you, Samantha. You can take it. That's why I did that.
I see your own children.
Yeah.
Wow. My favorite song. It changes, you know, over decades, but there is one song that is dear to me, and I put it on three albums.
Wow!
Because I don't know why. It's something magical in the melody or something, but it's called You Are.
Oh, I love that song.
It's the one no one can remember the title of. But
are you going to sing that for us?
Yes. Oh, I am?
Yeah.
Oh, I am.
You know, yeah, you are. And
you are. That's
Andrea remembers. Harriet doesn't remember. By the way, hang around because before we go out, Andrea Ross-Greene and Harriet Schock are going to do another of Harriet's songs to end with. I want to say a couple of hellos. Nancy Daly's with us.
Oh, Nancy Daly?
Nancy Daly is with us.
Do you know her?
Of course. Nancy did Women Who Write.
Oh, hell,
weren't you there? Yeah, I love Nancy.
Was she with the other two women or was she by herself?
No, she was by herself, right?
I love
her. But we have to have Nancy back. Catherine McClenahan is on. Hi, Catherine.
Catherine!
Crystal Husband. Hi, Crystal. I will
see
you Friday.
Yeah.
She's a sweetie. You met her at Women Who
Write,
right?
Sure. Well, no, I knew her years before.
Oh, wow.
Oh, she's a friend of Kangal Lovarado, my friend.
Okay, there you go. So, Pete, did we get all the questions?
No, we have more.
What else?
Okay.
Kathleen. Hi, Kathleen.
Let's see, what made you decide to teach songwriting, and when did you first start teaching?
I started teaching
Now they're asking my questions,
1986.
But that's okay.
And I...
Why? What
well, because
it?
A man called me who was head of the department. He's head of the Master Chorale. You probably know him. I'll go back to that in a minute. But okay. Basically, I said it couldn't be taught. I said, you can't teach songwriting. You either can do it or you can't. So the next year...
Let me just stop you for a second. The first song you ever wrote. What was the first song you ever wrote?
Oh, God. I was in the seventh grade.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't remember the name of it.
But what do you remember which you did first, lyric or music?
I started with the melody and the lyric together, but as we all know, the second verse you have to match the melody, so you have to have the ability to put words to music because the second verse requires that. All, in grade school, I'd been putting words to known melodies. Well, not grade school, but maybe sixth, fifth, and sixth grade. I started putting words to other people's melodies, but the seventh grade, that was the first one I ever wrote.
Okay.
So, but I told him, it was Morris Lorison, he's head of the Master Chorale, he's a brilliant composer. I called him Skip, because that was his nickname, and he said, you have to teach it. We're not going to offer it if you don't teach it. Now, we're talking USC, and they didn't have a department at the time.
Wow.
So I said, okay, the guilt squeezed me in. And then I'm in the studio the night before I'm teaching my first class, and I think, what can I, you know?
Wow.
So really, I was so unprepared, but the kids seemed to like it, but I didn't really perfect the steps.
Okay, I was going to say, you have a meth.
Yeah, until I stopped teaching USC, because the kids were not motivated like my students now. You know, it was daddy's money, it was a quick... It was
a few units that they're getting credit for.
You know, I could tell they weren't motivated, although a couple of them were kind of talented. Anyway, so I did that for 2 years, and then.
So now, while you're teaching classes at USC, are you're not developing your method?
Yeah,
at this
I'm developing,
point? You're developing
method,
it.
You but
are.
I wasn't.
But just by doing it,
later.
But by doing it, it's kind of coming to you how to do this.
Yeah, and actually, I've been teaching for 33 years, and over those years, I've perfected it.
Okay, so can you talk a little bit, without giving away, what people should come to your...
Because then I'd have to kill you.
All
those people who are watching.
Right, so we're not going to give away what happens at this table. You can teach it? Can you teach it to anybody?
Yeah, I've actually had people who... many people who have never written a song. Most
Suzanne Long, hi.
Yeah,
I believe
Suzanne
she
Long
wrote a couple of songs.
And Karen Gettisman, mm-hmm. and many people. Mm-hmm. But mostly, my system attracts already good writers.
Hi, Tracy Newman. I can't even think off the top of my head. There are so many who take your class. Hilary Rollins takes your class, doesn't
yes,
she?
Yes, she does.
She's an amazing songwriter.
My class is my social life, because... Mm-hmm. Once you get to know people that well, because they write the real thing they're feeling, you know, it's great.
So
I know I didn't answer that person's question.
Okay.
What was it?
So answer the question. What was the question?
I don't know.
Why did I start teaching?
Oh, why did you start teaching?
Yeah,
when
because then, yeah, that was why. Because they asked me 2 years in a row.
Got it. We have one more.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, this is also from Nancy. She says... you co-wrote a beautiful song, She Thought He Loved Her, with Michelle Crow Malone.
Uh-huh.
She wrote the lyrics. I love the song, and your gorgeous melody has long lingered for me. Will you ever play it at some future show?
Oh, yes, I do play that at shows. I just play different songs at different shows, but you weren't at the show I played it. But I do love that song, and I love the lyricist, Michelle, and I hope that she's watching.
Hi, Michelle. Do we get through the questions online so far?
That's so far, yeah.
Okay, so I have some more questions.
Okay.
So are there other people who have covered your song that you felt, has anyone done it better than you imagined?
Yes. A number of people have sung Ain't No Way to Treat a Lady. I won't go into the versions that I abhor.
By the way, I just want to say that there is nothing like a singer-songwriter doing their own work. And for me, your version of that kills.
Oh, thank you. I mean, I have to say that Helen was very close to my version, mm-hmm. and I loved what she did. And I loved the fact that, you know, I was anonymous all the way to the bank. But Letta Mbulu, who sang in Roots.
Okay.
And she did the verses in Xhosa, which is an African dialect with the clicking.
Wow.
And Herb Alpert produced it. You should look it up online. It is gorgeous.
I wouldn't know how to spell it to look it up online.
L-E-T-T-A and then M-B-U-L-U.
You'll give me that information and I'll put it in the notes so people can find it.
It's really beautiful. And she even did some interesting
things
with the with the melody, and I didn't expect them. And so usually I don't, you know, I mean, if someone is soulful, they can do anything they want. But if they change chords,
do you have input on that? Do you have input if somebody's going to do a cover of your song and you're not happy? You just have to deal.
Well, once a song is out there,
you
know, they don't have to ask your permission or any of that. And I didn't have input on anything, really.
I see.
Except, you know, I was in the studio with Johnny Mathis.
Wow. Okay, so what else, what other highlights have there been of people doing your music?
Oh, goodness. Well, Jeannie Kendall of the Kendalls, they had lots of hits. It was a father-daughter duo, and they had lots of hits about cheating, strangely enough, because they were called...
That's a little weird.
But the Pittsburgh Steelers, they did, you know, songs about that. Anyway, they had, like, number one hits one after another, but then her father died, mm-hmm. and she did an album, and she did a song of mine that I wrote with Holly Mathis. I know I said I don't collaborate.
I know, so far I've heard three more people you've collaborated with.
Holly, and it was called You Just Don't Get Me, Do Ya? And it, you know, it charted and stuff, and she did a beautiful job. Who else?
Who else? What other artists? Well, I think I have a list of, like, all of a bunch of the stuff that you've done with other people. That other people have done of you that have covered, and is there any? Okay, so I know you can't talk about some. You don't want to call anybody out that you've hated, but there have been versions.
No, I didn't really hate them, but there have been some pretty bad ones. And a very strange thing that happened was.
Yeah.
Okay, First Time on a Ferris Wheel was covered by, you know, at least 35 people have sung that song. I mean, not they haven't all recorded them, but, you know, they've been sung it. Well, Rebecca Paris and Nancy Wilson.
Okay, yeah.
And Carl Anderson and Nancy Wilson sang it at Carnegie Hall, and that's a video to watch.
Wow.
Because he loved her.
Wow.
And they sang that. But what I was going to tell you, Jeffrey Osborne was recording an album, mm-hmm. and Clive Davis was, I think he was recording him, and we sent it, and Jeffrey said that his first time on a Ferris wheel was not especially pleasant. So Brendan Okrent, who was at ASCAP at the time, she said, "So you rewrote it, didn't you, you whore?" She meant it lovingly.
Right.
But, you know, the fact is, it was perfect the way it was. She worked for the publishing company. But, you know, you want a Jeffrey Osborne cut. So, yes, I rewrote it. And, of course, he didn't cut it anyway. But one morning, I'm up, and I get this email that someone wants to cut that song. So, I pulled the lyric out, but I pulled the wrong one.
You pulled the one for Jeffrey Osborne?
It's called Distant Hill. And so I sent it to her, and she cut it anyway. So now there's another record out there. I don't even remember her name, but...
Wow, that's hysterical.
Somebody wants to know if there's a polka version.
Of which song?
Anything.
No, but that's a good category in the Grammys to be, because there are not many people in
the category. In the poker category? So you'll have to write a poker game, Harriet. So, all right, so I'm looking at television programs that have had your...
Well, I have a television show that I co-wrote the theme song for.
for called Jakers, The Adventures of Piggly Winks, and it's in 30 countries.
Oh, wow.
And it's just PBS, but if people have PBS kids, they can hear it.
And so what about films? What, any favorite? We're going to get to Henry, other than Henry.
Well, I loved Delta Force 2 has a song I co-wrote at the end of it called The Winds of Change. And it was supposed to happen when they dropped the drug dealers out of the plane.
But your mother must be so proud.
But it when it actually plays, it's over credits. And I thought, no. But anyway, it was fine. And, you know, Delta Force 2 was a big credit and everything. Then one day I got an email from a guy who's got a gun video. He's like something of... You have to understand, I'm from Texas. This doesn't bother me at all.
Oh, okay.
He's got a gun video, and he wants to use my song in it. And I said, okay, you know, whatever.
So did anybody ever ask you to put music to something that you didn't approve of, that you didn't want your music associated with?
Well, it's not a matter of associating with. Sometimes the lyrics just, you know, they don't move me in a way that I can think of music. So I turn it down, you know.
So now composing. So how do you meet Henry Jaglom, and how does that relationship start? For those of you who don't know, Henry Jaglom has, how many movies does Henry have?
Henry, 17.
17 movies. Henry edited Easy Rider. He was on Gidget. Henry's got the most varied, fabulous career. But, okay, so how did you meet Henry Jaglom?
Well, a long time ago, I went to see him with a script.
Oh.
His cinematographer and Misha paid me to write. And he was very nice about it. That's when I met him. He may or may not even remember that. Mm-hmm. And then years later, I would go see Andrea Markovici at the Gardenia, and he would be there. So I kind of knew him like that. Mm-hmm. And I mentioned to Andrea, you know, Henry Jaglom. So she saw that he was speaking at Rocket Video, and she said, you know, that man who read your script years ago, you should go. I said, I'm not going. She said, go. So we went, and I heard him say, I only make movies because I can't write songs. And I thought, I only write songs because I can't make movies. I am so going to work with that man. I just had that kind of intention.
Wow.
You know it's going to happen. So I spoke to him, and he was doing a movie called Going Shopping.
Mm-hmm.
And
his women's trilogy, part of the women's trilogy.
And I wanted to write a song, and so I sent it to him. He never got back to me. I didn't know that he didn't do things like that. So I asked him again, you know, and I finally sent him a CD, and his son, Simon, really liked it a little bit. He said, you know, that's got something. And
what's the first Henry film that your music was in?
Going Shop.
Oh, it was a Going Shopping.
Yeah,
okay.
I wrote the theme song, and then I underscored it with just piano.
And then how many films have you done with Henry since?
I think five, but one of them I was just in, you know, it was 45 minutes from Broadway,
yes,
just
45
minutes from Broadway, but I did none of them. No, there was no music of mine in it.
Uh-huh. And then the M Word.
Yeah, the M Word, I wrote the song, and Andrea singing it at
end. Which is fabulous.
Yep.
And you scored that as well.
I scored
it.
But what was really, no, I didn't really score that movie. I scored part of Hollywood Dreams. Mm-hmm. But when I was in the play of Just 45 Minutes from Broadway, this was one of the highlights of my life. Every night before I went on, everybody was getting their hair done and stuff. I was talking to Henry. Henry has stories.
I've interviewed him a few times, so I can say I know that to be true.
But for 1 year, every night we went on, I would talk to him for an hour.
Wow.
So I was just like, whatever book he was reading, whatever he was doing, I just wanted to hear him tell me. You know?
Wow. For those of you who don't know, Henry wrote a book called My Lunches with Orson. Henry had lunch with Orson Welles every day and recorded their conversations, and it's been transcribed, and it's an amazing,
really,
he's got amazing stories about Orson. And
yeah, and so Gary Imhoff directed the play that Henry wrote.
So after the play was over, I was, you know, going through withdrawals, not talking to Henry, aww, but also not hearing from Gary. So I joined his class, and I've been in it for 6 years now.
So do you audition for other things?
Oh, not really. I mean, I did one thing, judge somebody, and I got that, where you do improv these actual cases, you know.
Okay.
But it was fun. My case won. I mean, my side won.
Nice. Winning is good.
That's true.
Tommy Moore. Hi, Bob Nelson. Oh, my God. I was in an improv company with Bob Nelson in 1980.
Ooh. Really?
In 1983. Called
Don't
Laughter
you love
Company.
Improv?
And Eddie Murphy started in that group. And Rosie O'Donnell. I replaced Rosie O'Donnell because we're so much alike. But Bob was the creator of it, and Dave Hawthorne, who was Billy Crystal's partner before that, was a member in it, and Vinnie Mark. It was, yeah, fantastic.
Oh, that's great.
And so getting more current. So songwriting, your classes every week.
Well, I should probably say that, you know, during the 70s, I made those records. During the 80s, I worked with Misha Segal and had another publishing deal with Motown's publishing company.
Uh-huh.
And then in the 90s,
so you guys weren't, you guys were scoring, you guys were doing for TV and for film?
No.
You were doing
writing songs.
Okay. Uh-huh.
Yeah. And then we did that one movie that had Ferris Wheel. Then in the 90s.
Wait, I'm sorry, one more question with that. Did people record your songs that you wrote with Misha?
Yeah, some of them. Okay. Uh-huh. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So in the 90s, I met Nick Vinay in 1991, who was an icon in the industry and had discovered everybody from Linda Ronstadt.
Oh, wow.
You know, the Beach Boys, Bobby Darin, Jim Croce. And so he loved what I did in the 70s, and he said, you've gotten away from that. It wasn't so much what I did with Misha. It was that I was doing kind of mindless R&B. I don't know what I was doing.
Disco
came in at the end of the 70s, and I sort of forgot who I was. When I met Nick, he reminded me, you know, you're a songwriter. You're not just this one little thing you've become. So he had me start writing songs again, and he really made a huge impact on me. So I made 3 albums with him. Let me see. I made, American Romance and Rosebud, but 2 versions of Rosebud. And then I wrote this book.
Let's show it.
Yeah, and his wisdom is throughout, because I was working with him and quoting him quite often. Becoming Remarkable for Songwriters and Those Who Love Songs.
Okay, show the book so they can see it. Hold it up. There you go. Okay.
And inside it is the Rosebud CD, which has the lyrics in the back of the book.
Fantastic.
And so that was a leap for me, because, you know, you don't do something for 10 years, you forget who you are, you know. But he completely rehabilitated that part of my creative abilities. So then I started performing again, and, you know, and it's been ever since, you know. But really the 90s started the new me, old me.
And so the new old you, what is the new old you today? What is that for you?
Well,
what's your life? What's your love?
I love the writing. Whatever I'm doing, I think this is my favorite thing. You know, when I'm writing's my favorite thing. But dear God, performing. You know, you could tell how much I love that.
Fantastic.
So, and when I'm teaching, and you would not believe the wins I've had in teaching recently. I mean, people saying that, you know, their lives have changed, that they want to live. I mean, stuff you wouldn't believe. I mean, if I never heard another good thing about my teaching, this week I've heard enough that it was worth it for 33 years. Yeah, I've been doing it. And this week I just had 2 people tell me things that it was like, okay, it was all worth it just to hear that.
Wow. Any standout, I mean, I know all your students are standouts. Any songs that came out of this room that you're really proud. You have.
Well,
I mean a ton.
Tracy Newman alone. Aww. I mean, you know, Waffle Boy. Are you kidding? And I mean, My Baby's Baby. She's a master.
Yeah, she's fantastic. You know, I was talking about her today. She's
but
amazing.
I mean, she was good when she. I'm like the photographer that everybody says, how do you get those pictures of tomatoes to look like that? He says, well, I have people bring in tomatoes. I say, no, I get the perfect tomato. I take a picture of it. I find a great songwriter. I start teaching them, and then I take all the credit. But actually, I think she may have learned something from me, but she was always good. Mm. You know?
Anybody else stand out?
Oh, God. I have so many good students.
I know. Just pick one more out.
Okay.
David Lucky's pretty great.
But he's never studied with me. He's threatened.
Wow. I thought he was yours.
No,
I thought I met him through you.
I would love to.
David, you have to study with Harry.
Yeah,
are you
right.
Kidding me?
He needs me.
so tell me somebody else.
Huh?
That's hilarious.
Oh.
I thought.
Well, do you know who Nita Whitaker is?
I don't.
She's an amazing singer. She used to sing all of David Foster's demos. She's a wonderful writer, too, and she studied with me. You should look her up. She's just brilliant.
Is she still around? Is she still in LA?
No, she's not studying with me right now, but... Laura Joy Gold, Kevin Kelso, Betsy Jackson. I mean, Hannah. Do you know?
I know everyone you just mentioned. I don't know Hannah.
You don't know Hannah Weiss?
Mm-mm.
It's Chana. Maybe that helps. No, but anyway, she has written so many musicals. So right now she has two musicals going to New York.
Wow.
I mean, she's just like unbelievable.
Wow.
And Hillary Rollins.
Oh, Hillary is unbelievable. Yeah.
My Monday class just... It rocks. I'm not kidding. And
so how can people, if people out there are aspiring, how can they get in your class? What do they do?
If they go to harrietschock.com and contact me. And,
So now they don't have to be...
Or message me on Facebook.
Okay. But they don't have to be prolific songwriters to come in. They can have never written a song,
yeah.
Correct?
And yeah. See, what it does for the novice, the person who's not an experienced songwriter is... It keeps them from making all the horrible mistakes that most people do. It gives them a step-by-step method that gives them a seamless song the first time. Of course, they say, oh, well, this is easy. They don't realize that I've saved them 10 years of doing it the way they would have done it. But that's okay.
But so does everybody leave your class with a song?
Yeah. I don't have to break bad habits. That's why I like people who've never written a song.
Uh-huh.
But like Tracy says on the video she made about my play, she said, there are songs you'll just write, but the tough song, the one that you really are having trouble with, the steps make it so much easier.
Wow, that's good to know. I like that.
I can tell you want to write a song.
I had a phrase today that I wrote down that, here, tell me if this is a lyric. I wrote it down today because it, let me see. I can't love you more and care less. I don't know, but it just came to me today. I said, I think that's, I don't know if it's, I don't know what it is, but it was, I said it out loud. And
do
I said,
you mean to, you can't love him more and simultaneously care less?
Correct. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can't care less for you and love you more. Yeah, that's what I mean. Mm-hmm.
How about if I couldn't care less, I might love you more.
I like that better. I like that better. See, that's why you're a teacher.
Yeah.
That's why you're a song teacher.
No,
a songwriting teacher.
The good thing is, in my class, you don't start with a title. Titles are very important, but you want to communicate. And my steps keep you communicating at all times. Most people, they can communicate perfectly, but then the minute they start songwriting, they start speaking a language they don't speak fluently, and it sounds like it.
That's interesting, because when I write articles, I start with a title.
Uh-huh.
And, I mean, I have what I want to talk about.
Yeah.
But usually the title will come to me first, and it'll be the one that'll stick.
Sure.
Yeah.
But, I mean, people can barely say the pen is on the table in the language of songwriting, and they want to talk about the meaning of life. So if I keep them communicating in English instead of songwriting, they end up with a song.
That's very interesting. I like that.
Of course, the music is a little different. If they have no ear whatsoever, there's a way I can help them write a lyric to give to someone else. But if they have an ear, even if they don't play, mm-hmm. I can help them.
Wait a minute, so someone can come in and write a song who doesn't play?
Yeah. Because there are instruments all over the place. You hit one note, it plays a whole arpeggio, you hit another note. You don't have to know how to play, but you have to be able to hear.
Right. You have to be able to sing it. To communicate it to someone else who can play it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That too.
So, Pete, do we have any other questions before we go hear some music?
Yes.
We do? Okay, let's hear them. What are they, Pete?
Let me see. Did you ever...
Hi, Michael.
Have you ever had any other career besides songwriting?
Well, I have 8 earning careers right now. I'm a songwriter. I'm a performer. I'm a recording artist. I'm an author. I'm a teacher. I'm an actor. So, I've had a lot of careers, but not... I think you mean before I could make a living as a songwriter. Mm. Briefly, I was an advertising copywriter. Wow. And I still hear ads that I think is great, like... I saw a billboard the other day I thought was really clever, but now I can't remember it. But anyway, so I'm still kind of thinking, like, it's interesting because headlines and titles are very similar. You have to give them a benefit in the headline. You have to give them something, you know, to reach for in the title of a song also.
One more just popped up.
Go ahead.
What's your favorite movie of 2019 so far?
Hi, Josh Sussman.
Oh, my God. Oh, I love movies and I go every week. Okay. What was it that I was raving about? Dear God. I have to think about that for a minute. It'll pop into my head. I'm so sorry because I do love movies so much.
So tell us a couple that you've loved in the last year or two that have really stood out for you.
Andrea and I started watching Malice because it was from the 90s.
Uh-huh.
But I had never seen it.
I've never seen it.
It's got who all is in it?
I know nothing about
it. It's got Anne Bancroft.
Anne Bancroft.
Who was the main guy? And Nicole Kidman.
Oh.
And you know the brother, the guy.
You know the guy.
Look it up.
Alec Baldwin.
Oh, that guy.
Yeah. Oh, he was so cute in the 90s.
My husband went to college with him. They were at Lee Strasberg together at NYU. Yeah, they were in the same class. Not bad company to keep. So we are going to hear a song now.
Okay.
So tell us a little bit. Harriet's a wonderful singer-songwriter who tells us about her music. Jim Croce, you mentioned, by the way, I saw him at Carnegie Hall.
Oh.
And he was the opening act, and he only had one hit out at the time. And I think he opened for Cat Stevens, but... We were so mesmerized by Jim. He was a singer-songwriter who told the whole thing. He would talk for a half hour before he would like sing the song, like 20 minutes before he'd sing the song. It was, and then by the time he sang the song, it was like, oh my God, it was amazing, yeah.
Oh, I'm sure, yeah, no, Nick worked with him, and.
Wow. So, but you do a lot of that when you perform. You do a lot of telling the story. The song becomes so much more important and precious because we understand what it is. So tell us.
Do you want me to, which one do you want, over and over and over, which we gave?
Why don't you do both of them? Why don't you do over and over and okay. You are.
Okay. I'll tell you about over and over and over because... Okay. I live in this duplex, and I have for so many years, and when I first moved in, an elderly couple was upstairs, and I was afraid I was making too much noise, and so I was being very silent as much as possible, and one day, the woman called me, and she invited me up for fruit, and I thought, well, she's in her 90s, maybe that's why, what do they eat, you know? So I went up there, and I was so impressed by how positive they were about their lives, their children, their grandchildren, their pets. And I came home and I actually was inspired to write a song for them. So I called her and I said, Faye, I've written a song about your marriage. I hope that's all right. And she said, well, it certainly can't harm the relationship. And then she said, everything only makes it better. And I thought, God, this woman is so smart. So they got all dressed up and came downstairs to hear my song. And I played it for them. And I gave her a lyric sheet. They were very polite. And then went back upstairs. And then she called me and she said, you know, we just read the lyric. This is really good. We couldn't hear when you were playing it. So then I didn't worry about making too much noise.
All right. Well, let's go hear it over and over. And thank you so much, Harriet. I'm going to say this now. I'm going to bring a light with me so that Pete is going to follow. And we're gonna go inside and we're going to get a little mini concert. We're going to get a couple of Harriet Schock songs, and Andrea Ross-Greene's rejoining us. And let's go close so people get a good view.
Yes, this is what I played at the very beginning, if you've been with us from the beginning. Someone. It was the beginning of a new relationship and the first argument, you know. So I knew I could either just make him wrong and sing it in public and publicly humiliate him, you know, do all the horrible things that songwriters do, or
I could get underneath all of the anger to the fear and vulnerability. And I think that's why this song is so important to me, because I did that. And I wrote it during the time that he wouldn't pick up the phone when I was trying to reach him. It's called You Are.
Static things.
Oh,
I was
really?
Told for some of that. Mm. So Pete was saying it was going in and out.
Yeah.
And
it was fine, and then it would get going back.
So I'm sorry for that. We're live on Facebook. We are uncontrolled for this, but I will give you links so that you'll be able to hear those songs.
There's no static on the record.
There's no static on the record.
Or in the show.
And I will give or in the shows, and I will give you links so that you can purchase Harriet's music on Spotify. On
well, you don't purchase on Spotify.
Without static, because they're so beautiful. We had the benefit of hearing them live. Thank you so much
Thank
for doing
you.
This.
What a wonderful interviewer you are.
Thank you. And so next week, we're going to have Jerry Jewell, who's going to be with us, and then I'm going to New York for Samantha's graduation from NYU, and I'm going to be interviewing my old friend, Steve Conti, who has had the coolest song in the world on the FM Garage a couple of times, and I could not be more excited. Thank you so much again. Pete, thank you so much.
Yay.
And thank you all for being with us. We'll see you next week.